righty. So we're wrapping up eschatology tonight, God's willing. And we started out with the objectives of the study, to have a working knowledge of the doctrine of eschatology, develop a greater understanding of our role in the world as believers and living in anticipation of Christ's glorious return. We went ahead and we defined eschatology as from two Greek words, eschatos meaning last, and logos meaning doctrine or study. Therefore, eschatology we define as a doctrine concerning last things. Let us not forget that the rapture is imminent, meaning it can occur at any time. There is no specific event that must take place before the rapture. Let us also bear in mind that a thousand years is like a day in the sight of God. So for those who are saying, you know, we have been living past 2,000 years and we have been hearing that he's coming back, he hasn't come yet, we must bear in mind that it's just like 2 days in the sight of God. We took a look at the Old Testament's prophets, mountain range view of Christ coming. And when they looked, even the apostles, if we understand the Gospels, they were confused. They didn't have clarity like we do because we're looking back. When they looked, they saw this mountain range view of Christ coming. And so it appears as if it's one advent. And so they expected him to set up his kingdom while he was on earth. And if you notice, we have this mystery, the church ages call a mystery, because it was not clearly revealed in the Old Testament. So that's the first major gap between the first advent and the rapture. Remember, the rapture can occur at any moment. It's imminent. And so, you know, what that does with those who see the church going through the tribulation or anything of that sort, that's really a misnomer, because the rapture is imminent. Now, the second advent, there's this 7-year gap between the rapture and the second advent, or the revelation of Christ. So at that point, you know, there are signs, as we see in Matthew 24, that will take place before that happens. Alrighty. We went ahead and we look at the rapture. We look at, you know, which is the first phase of the second coming. We look at the second advent. We look at the tribulation period. And then we move into the millennium. And so now we're going to go straight into the eternal state. Alrighty, so we are now in the eternal state. And when we think of the eternal state, we think of beauty, we think of majesty, we think of glory, because that's what the eternal state is. So here's the eternal, the chart of the stuff that we've looked at so far. So we have the rapture, and we know the judgment seat of Christ takes place in heaven. Then we have the marriage of the Lamb during that 7-year period, while the tribulation is taking place here on earth. Then we have the second advent of Christ, and we have a number of judgments that will take place at that time. Then we have the 1,000-year reign of Christ, which is the millennium. Then we have the end of the millennium will be the great white throne. And then we will move into the eternal state. So these are events between the millennium and the eternal state. So we have the millennium over on my left, and then we have the eternal state on the right. We have Satan and his emissaries will be taken care of first, then unbelievers. Then we have the death and Hades will be taken care of, and then we have earth and heaven will be dissolved. And we're going to take a look at these. All right, so the final estate of Satan. So these are the events between the millennium and the eternal state. Revelation 27 to 10. First, once the millennium is over, because he will be bound for that 1,000 years. And then when the 1,000 years are completed, Satan will be released from his prison, from the abyss. And he will come out to deceive the nations, which are at the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together for the war. The number of them is like the sand on the seashore. And they came upon the broad plain of the earth and surrounded the camp of the saints and the beloved city. And fire came down from heaven and devoured them. So the nations, you know, as we mentioned last week, kids will be born. A lot of kids will be born. Many of them will choose not to trust Christ as Savior. And so once Satan is, once Satan is released, he will gather them together to war against Christ. Then he is judged and consigned to the lake of fire. Remember, the beast and the false prophets, they were the first two to go into the lake of fire. Now Satan has joined them with the rest of his host. And the devil, verse 10 of Revelation 20, who deceived them, was thrown into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophets are also, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. Then we will have the final estate of unbelievers. Final estate of unbelievers. They will be resurrected. Revelation 20, verse 13. And the sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades gave up the dead who were in them, and they were judged, each one of them, according to their deeds. Now, these are the resurrected unbelievers. All of those who are saved are taken care of already. These are unbelievers. Then they will be judged at the great white throne and consigned to the lake of fire. Revelation 20, 11 to 12, verse 15 and 21, verse 8. Revelation 20, verse 11 and 12, it says, then I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it, from whose presence the earth and the heaven fled. The earth and the heaven fled, and no place was found for them. And I saw the dead, the great and the small, standing before the throne, and the books were open. And another book was open, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged from the things which were written in the books according to their deeds. The books concerning their works, their deeds. And if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. And so all those folks will be consigned to the lake of fire. Then 21 verse 8. But for the cowardly, the unbelieving, and the abominable and murderers and sexual immoral persons and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars, their part will be in the lake that burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. Remember, death simply means separation. So when we die, well, we are born dead spiritually, and then physical death is a separation of the soul and the body, and then the second death is separation eternally from God. And the final estate of death and Hades, Revelation 20, verse 14, both death and Hades will be consigned to the lake of fire. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death, the lake of fire. This is called Gehenna in the Greek. The Hades is a transliteration. And then death. Then we have the dissolution of the present heavens and the earth. Revelation 20, verse 11b, and 2 Peter 3, 10 to 12. From whose presence earth and heaven fled, and no place was found for them. Revelation 20, 11b. And then 2 Peter 3, 10 to 12. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, in which the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the elements will be destroyed with intense heat, and the earth and its works will be discovered. Since all these things are to be destroyed in this way, what sort of people ought you to be in holy conduct and godliness, looking for and hastening coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be destroyed by fire and the elements will melt with intense heat. But according to his promise, we are looking for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. So these are events between the millennium and the establishment of the eternal state. All right, so let's now take a look at the ushering in of the eternal state. We're going to have the creation of the new heavens and earth. Remember, heaven was polluted when Satan fell, so it needed to be purged, just as the earth will need to be purged because of sin. Isaiah 65, 17, for behold, I create new heavens and a new earth, and the former things will not be remembered or come to mind. Then 66:22 of the same Isaiah, for just as the new heavens and the new earth which I make will endure before me, declares the Lord, so will your descendants and your name endure. 2 Peter 3:13, but according to his promise, we're looking for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. We're talking about absolute, complete righteousness. And then Revelation 21:1, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. The first heaven and the first earth pass away, and there is no longer any sea. Then there'll be the new Jerusalem. So we have the new heavens and the new earth. And remember, we talk about the fact that there are three heavens, the atmospheric heaven, the starry heaven, and then the third heaven. And the third heaven is where God dwells. The angelic beings, at least the evil angels, are in the starry heavens. And you know, we participate in the atmospheric heaven. Revelation 21, verse 2, and I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is among the people, and he will dwell among them, and they shall be his people, and God himself will be among them. And he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will no longer be any death. There will no longer be any mourning, or crying, or pain. The first things have passed away. Remember, we talk about the millennium, that the curse will be lifted, not completely, but once the new heavens and the new earth have been created and the new Jerusalem, everything is perfect. Verse 10, and he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain and showed me the holy city Jerusalem coming down out of heaven from God, having the glory of God. Her brilliance was like a very valuable stone, like a stone of crystal clear jasper. We have the dimension of this city, of this new Jerusalem. Then, you know, perhaps this is the city for which Abraham looked. Hebrews 11:10 and verse 15. The one that we believers today seek in Hebrews 13 and verse 14. Now, when we talk about the eternal city and the entire new earth, let's bear in mind, we were created to live on earth, and we're going to come back after the 7-year period in heaven. We're going to return to earth because earth is our abode. It would be a life of worship. You're talking about perfection. And we can only imagine the grandeur, the beauty, the splendor of new earth, what it will be like. You know, we only know corruption. And because we are corrupt, it's difficult for us to see the beauty of this eternal city and this eternal new earth. So worship will be a pleasure. It will be a joy. We won't have, you know, folks drifting like we do today. But it will be perfect. It will be a life of fellowship. You know, we are selfish on earth because we are corrupt. We have been affected by sin. And so we tend to be selfish. But in the eternal city, fellowship will be the norm. There'll be a life of full knowledge. There'll be a life of holiness. Why? Because we have new bodies like Christ. So we don't have to eat to live anymore. We eat now because we're dying. So we eat to replenish the cells and the tissues. Once we get into the eternal city, the new earth, everything will be perfect. It'll be a life of rest. It'll be a life of joy. We're talking about complete joy. You've had a moment or two in your lifetime when you enjoy joy. It will be a blissful experience, one that I don't know if any human being can describe. It will be a life of service. It will be a life of abundance. It will be a life of glory. You know, when we sing the songs that at breaking of bread, and we sing, that will be glory for me, glory for me, glory for me. Our bodies will be like Christ. And if you remember when Christ, after his death, and he put on his glorified body, Remember, he ate, he could eat, but he didn't eat because he needed to eat. It was a pleasure for him to eat. He was not limited by objects. He could walk between walls. No, I don't know, but if our body is like Christ's body, then probably we'll be able to do that too. Because every human being in the new earth would have been perfected by God. That takes us to the end of the eternal state. So I'm going to open it up now for questions. Everyone just say it.